silhouette, avoiding you like I'm an acrobat. You're everywhere, I'm not okay with that. 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 Put it down. It's 2 a.m. Where are you now? What's his name? I'll figure it out. Wait, what am I saying? Jay, put it down. And now I think I hate the internet, 'cause every shape looks like your silhouette, avoiding you like I'm an acrobat. You're everywhere, I'm not okay with that. Now I think I'll leave you in the past. I'm better off just taking what I have. I won't see you around over my head, not anymore, and I'm okay with that.
Hey, my name's Jamie. About to go on a walk with Jake. He's got a new project coming out. It's going to take us to some places that are significant to that project here in Nashville. And let's go see what he's got in store. Brenton. What up? So here we are. It's nice. We're here in Nashville. And you got a new album coming out.
Yeah, I'm excited about it.
Me too. Tell us a little bit about what it's all about.
Well, it's called Who's Gonna Break Your Heart Tonight. It's pretty emo.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's like I was thinking about making this album, and then I wrote this entire record that was like 10 or 11 songs, and then I decided that it wasn't good enough.
You just scrapped the whole thing?
Yeah.
It never came out.
Yeah, it never came out. The only song that made it through was a song called Okay With That. Mm-hmm. And I kept that song. And then I made a whole other album. Because I feel like the people that listen to my music, they desire like that kind of emotional connection.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I felt like the first album that I wrote, I just kind of like, I don't know, it didn't mean as much. So I made another album, and people always ask me, like, especially when I first started Fangs, they'd be like, why do you make the kind of music that you make? And I would always say, like, well, my parents were really young when they had me, and so I grew up different than a lot of other kids, because they, like, my friends would grow up and watch, like, Barney and Sesame Street and stuff like that, and I was, my first, like, memory of music is, like, watching MTV Spring Break.
Oh, wow. So that young.
Yeah. So I was doing that, and that's the kind of music that I've always liked. Janet and Michael and Whitney and
yeah.
TLC and all that. And so I then was trying to think of like why, like when was it that music actually meant something to me? And that would have been like, I don't know, whenever I was 12, 13.
Yeah.
And I would just be sitting in my room, listening to an album front to back and thinking of like just like reading through the booklet on it and being like, you know, who's John Anderson? And,
yeah.
And like, what's an assistant engineer? What does that even do? I wonder what.
Getting outside of Texas a little bit.
Yeah. And just trying to figure out like everything about the album. I wanted to know everything. And these songs just all meant something to me, especially experiencing it front to back. And that's really where I felt like I connected to music the most. So I wanted to make an album that meant that to me. And yeah. Mean that to the random, you know, kid in Des Moines, Iowa or somewhere that's just like, had a shitty day and needs to go home and just deal with stuff in their room.
Yeah.
So,
is that kind of how it was written, just like in a different series of places like this, that where you're alone or meant something to you? I know a lot's happened probably in your life since between your last album and this one.
Yeah, a lot has happened. And I don't know. I think that that's just like, I spend a lot of time touring, and I'm in hotel rooms by myself. I'm in studios by myself. And most of the studios that people like assume that I'm in, they assume it's like some big, crazy, like fancy place, but it's really just bedrooms.
Yeah.
And so this entire album has been written and recorded in bedrooms. And that's where like the original inspiration was for me as a preteen in a bedroom. So I just wanted to like...
come full circle.
Yeah. So we're just walking around Nashville now, and I'm going to take you to a bunch of bedrooms that like mean something to me.
All right. I love it. I love it. It's a far stretch difference to our normal hangout at a Hollow Moon conspiracy meeting. It's educational, really.
Yeah.
But I'm excited. And let's do this.
Yeah, we'll just go up here and then like turn right.
So where are we stopping first here?
We're going to my drummer Tom's house first.
All right, and how did you meet Tom?
Tom, I was in a pinch. I used to tour as a three-piece whenever I first started Fangs. And, I mean, I say tour, I'd played like three shows.
Yeah.
And those two other guys that played with me last minute, like, couldn't do it anymore. And I had a tour booked already that I had to go on, where I was like support for a good friend of mine, R. Lamar. And while like literally 10 days before the tour, I needed a drummer, and I started texting around in Nashville because it's Nashville and everybody plays music. And a friend referenced me to a friend that then told me, oh, I know this guy, Tom, but you should get coffee with him first.
You never met him before.
Never met him. And so, like,
but the first thing is, hey, well, look, maybe you should have a contact point with him.
Yeah. So, like, 5 days before the tour starts, I go and get coffee with Tom. And he's super cool. And he said he, like, knew most of the songs already. He had, like, heard my stuff. And
he's a fan.
Yeah. And he was really great. And we did one rehearsal. It's the only rehearsal we've ever had, actually. Yeah. And it was great. And
wait, in all the tours you guys have done, just one rehearsal?
Yeah, we've never rehearsed. I just, like, send him the tracks, and he rehearses them at his place where we're headed. And I rehearse on my end, and then we show up to the show, and we play them.
All right.
Just make it feel good. But,
What can we expect walking into this place? I mean, it's Tom's domain.
So, well, there's a place right here on the street called Dairy King.
Dairy King.
And, and it's, like, a restaurant thing, and he lives literally right behind it in this little apartment with, like, I don't know, like four or five guys. I never know. But yeah, it's interesting. It's all like, right. It's just a bunch of young guys all living together, which is a very Nashville.
Yeah,
yeah, it's a very Nashville thing. They all like play music or have other hobbies that they're super into. And yeah, it's going to be fun.
So this is it. This is Tom's dwelling.
This is the dwelling.
This is Tom's dwelling. I'll show you guys. There's a game room over here.
A game room. Oh, now this is a... when you say a game room, Tom.
Yes. Game room would be an understatement. There's plenty of games in here.
That's for sure. Yeah.
This is what we got. So, yeah, gotta have the classic Michael Jackson poster, and then just wake up, just play, listen to music. Got a little vinyl collection I'm starting to acquire.
Lovely.
Slowly but surely.
And Jake, you used to stay here before you guys go out on tour a lot when you lived in Texas?
Yeah, when I lived in Texas for like a year, when we would start a tour, we would start out of Nashville. And I would come and stay in one of the other rooms here.
It did super nice now.
Really?
Nothing like it did before. I almost want to show you, but...
When I would stay here, it's just it's a room with no windows at all. And there's just a mattress on the floor.
It's a dungeon.
I would stay here at the Dairy Kingdom, and we would... leave the next day on tour.
Mom, thank you for the coffee.
Dude.
Does the body good?
Yes, it does. Yes,
so
it does.
Tell me a little bit about how it is to play with Jake and how you guys
it's
met.
It's honestly, like, really awesome and really fun. And we met, actually, through a friend of mine who connected us. He wasn't able to do a tour, and he just kind of, like, brought my name up. So since then, we've been rocking and rolling.
It's been a couple years.
It's been a couple years now. Yeah, so it's been pretty amazing. I have, like, a lot of creative control in my playing and what I do. And honestly, I think we're a good team because Jake is really good at just creating an atmosphere with the brand and just the way he approaches the brand for everyone else to just kind of have free reign over, like, their control,
absolutely,
their creative control, and do what they want. And doesn't interfere. It's just, it's
yeah,
open for everything. So
hard not to fall in love spending so much time on the road together.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
That's a challenge.
Yeah.
That's a challenge.
It's
right
tough
there.
Duty. Yeah.
So what
yeah,
is your favorite song on the new project?
So my favorite song will probably have to be just Powerline as an overall song. And just, it just kind of covers everything. I think
covers
that's a
great everything.
Song. Yeah.
Gets you right here.
It gets you right here.
And it's fun
right
to
there,
play.
And it's fun to play.
Do you remember when we first heard it? Like the final
yeah,
version of it?
Yeah. Yeah, dude. Yeah. And just
I think we were driving to, like, Indianapolis or Chicago
yeah,
or something. But we got the mix, and I think we listened to it in the van, like, 15, 20 times in a row.
Yeah.
We were really
that's
high
actually
on
how it happened.
Just singing and being
yeah,
happy and it's
yeah,
awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you guys are going to give us a little preview here.
Yeah, we'll
yeah,
do, like, a strip version.
Awesome.
Absolutely.
Cool.
I can't pretend.
thank you for allowing us to invade your space and get to know you a little better.
Oh,
yes. Look into your eyes.
Oh, I love it.
Hey.
Yes.
Well, you are welcome, and you can come anytime you please.
Do you have any wisdom to, leave us with?
Just be happy and have a good time, I guess. No, I don't know. Any wisdom? Wow, we could go on for days with this one. We could. Maybe that's a disc golf.
That's a disc golf.
We're gonna get out of here. And no, yeah. No, I'm joking. Yeah. Hey, bless him.
No. Yes.
Bless him.
Love it.
Bye, Thomas.
Bye.
So I think that I met you probably just before or right around the time when Fangs was becoming was genesising.
Yeah.
How long ago was that?
It's been like right at 3 years.
Wow.
It's crazy. It's like, feels like so much has happened, but also it's been like not that long realistically. Yeah. I don't know. It's crazy.
What was that like just kind of pushing out on your own, you know, putting yourself out there, doing the music?
Yeah, I mean, I've been doing music to some degree for a long time now. But this has been the first thing that felt like it was like truly like my thing.
Yeah.
Like my voice. So it's been interesting. It's been like 3 years, and the first like EP that I released was called Get In My Arms.
Yeah.
And I didn't really, it was fun because I didn't really have any expectation. Like nobody knew who I was. Nobody knew what I was doing. So it was cool to just kind of experiment and make what I thought was cool with no like expectation from anybody else.
Yeah, kind of freedom. It's in a, you're like birthing a new little baby out into the world.
Yeah, I mean, like I mentioned before, like this time I wrote an entire record and then scrapped it because there is an expectation. Like that didn't exist before, so it was kind of fun to just do that. It's still fun, but that was like an exciting time.
Yeah, absolutely.
So actually, this neighborhood, we're in East Nashville. This neighborhood, this house that's like right over here, we can go across. This greenhouse, my friend Chase, who randomly is also from Tyler, Texas, where I'm from, he moved to Nashville, and I was telling him about Fangs, and this is where he used to live. And we recorded pretty much the entire Get In My Arms album in his like bedroom studio.
Just a home studio right here.
Yeah, it's literally like, it's that window, this window on this side. That was like the studio, and we recorded it just like in that room. It was crazy. It's weird, like it felt bigger, even just like the house felt bigger 3 years ago. But we did the whole thing right there. And
with no expectations that it would lead you 3 years later.
Yeah, to like what this has become and what these fans are, and I don't know, it's crazy. But Chase actually lives like right down here, like around the corner. We can go over to his new house. He doesn't live there anymore. I don't know who lives there. But he's still totally part of the team. He's been doing the lights for my shows forever. So
you still write with him?
We don't write as much anymore, but he's definitely like a huge part of Fangs still, as far as just like the touring aspect. He cleans up all of my live sessions on my computer and does all the things that I don't know how to do.
Yeah. I can't wait to meet him.
Yeah, so we can go over there.
Yeah. So we're walking up to Chase's house.
Yeah, this is Chase's new place that he lives in.
We're gonna see what he has to say.
Yeah.
Right, Chase, thank you for letting us come into your space.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Thanks.
I love it. Love your setup here.
Appreciate it.
You've known Jake for a while. You guys are from the same hometown. So tell me a little bit about like what brought you here and how you guys started working together.
Yeah. So Jake's a couple years older than I am. So we both grew up. We went to the same high school. And I remember he was always the like cool older kid that was in bands. And I remember the first time that our bands played together, like just feeling super stoked to like get to do a show with his band, and there was a couple other local bands, and we also were like playing at this really cool old theater that was like, you know, old like 100-year-old wood stage and
awesome.
Auditorium, and so and then Jake
that was a Valentine's Day show. That was like the same time.
Oh, that's right.
That was like
that's crazy.
That is crazy.
Today is the day after Valentine's Day. But
that's nuts.
It's interesting.
But yeah, so Jake moved up to Nashville. My band and I, we stayed local and kind of did the thing. And I always, you know, kind of followed from afar and mm-hmm. was like really impressed with, you know, all the things that, you know, him and Cardboard Kids were doing. And I remember there was a trip that we came up, I think in the fall of 2014. Mm. My band and I, we had like just put out a record and, you know, coming to Nashville like was the thing to do after you release a record. And we didn't really have an agenda. We were just like, let's go up and like hang out with some people that we know. And
check
Jake was one of those people. Yeah. And so I remember we met up at Mitchell and...
Best sandwiches.
Yes.
Agree.
Which is crazy now that I live like less than a mile from Mitchell, which mm-hmm. is awesome. But yeah, so we met up and I remember we like just sat and talked for a couple hours about Nashville, how cool it was, like, you know, all the success that, you know, had been afforded to him just by moving up here and mm-hmm. making the jump. And I remember it was like in that moment, I tell people all the time that I was just like, yep, this is it. Like, I got
to
move
up. You just knew right then.
I knew right there. I'd always kind of wanted to do it, but that was kind of like the... Yeah, what am I waiting for?
Yeah,
let's make it happen.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
That's great. And since then, just been working together on Fangs, and you're doing lights, he said, for his upcoming shows?
Yeah, he's done it for all of my shows.
Oh, wow.
Actually, since the beginning, it's been like a 3-year thing now or something. The first show that I ever played as Fangs was I was on tour playing in Reliant K, and I got a phone call for an offer for this tour or for the show in Nashville, and it was going to be the first show, and I called Chase immediately and was like, hey, I fly back in the day before this show, can we make it happen? And he like made everything work.
Yeah, that was crazy because like at the time we had just started making music together, and like we had a couple songs that were like in a session, and he had a couple other songs as like other producers
mm-hmm.
and so he called me and he was like, can we do this show? Like, we don't even have a live Ableton set to like run tracks with or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was like a week's heads up or something.
Yeah, it was super short.
Yeah.
From scratch.
Ooh. So I was like, you know, yeah, let's make it happen. And so that basically meant like a lot of coordination between like other producers, getting stems, building a track. And then I remember too, like about that show, we kind of like collectively decided we should use lights from the onset. And so Jake was like, hey, if I buy these 4 like little par cans, I think it was like a Black Friday deal
or
something.
Yeah, it was a Black Friday deal.
And they were like $50 a piece. And he was just like, if I buy these, could we do something with them? And I was like, yeah, like I've kind of dabbled with lights, but like just I'll figure it out.
Yeah.
And so it was really cool. Just like kind of a like make it happen attitude. And
yeah,
sure enough, we had lights the first show. We had tracks.
It was cool. The show was sold out. To our disbelief, I don't know.
Yeah.
It was like sold out, and people like knew the songs, and
wow.
people drove from like Texas and Florida and Alabama
really cool.
and Chicago,
mm-hmm.
and it was like crazy. They were like fans,
you know,
for the first show, and it got to come to life really because of Chase more than me even. So it was really crazy, and then we ended up just making a whole album. Kind of with no really intent to make one. We were just making songs, and then it was like,
yeah.
I think we have an album here.
Yeah.
I think this could work.
Yeah. That first show was, like, really interesting, too, because, like, you know, Jake had a following
mm-hmm.
on social media, but sometimes that can be deceptive, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you can have followers, but, like, you know, engagement can be low. But
yeah.
that was, like, a really kind of, like, oh, this is something important.
Yeah.
Like, the first show, the fact that you've had people driving from out of state to come to a show.
Yeah, you don't see that very often.
It was really unique. And from that moment on, I was like, this is cool. Let's like, ride this momentum and keep doing stuff. And, yeah, like you said, we just
crazy.
Wrote a bunch of songs and made an album.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, that's awesome. I'm liking you guys' aura here. So I'm going to step out and let you play us a little music.
Yeah. We'll do one from, like, the first releases that we ever did. I think it'll be cool.
All right, awesome.
Just trying to be inside of yours, overthinking all these feelings. Could I have done some more? No. Am I running out of I'm still holding on. Don't go. I need you here. Don't go. Don't leave me here. Don't go. I need you to know I'm holding on. Won't be you all and lonely. We turn this hourglass over. I think I'm going insane. Every second passing by, I'm losing more with every grain. Oh no. Am I running out of time? Is it too late to rewind? 'Cause I'm still holding on. Don't go. I need you here. Don't go. Don't leave me here. Don't go. I need you to know I'm holding on. Won't be you all alone.
This is very brief too. So.
This was pretty brief, but I feel like I've been charged by your gaze. Yes. Honestly, I'm charged up. But thank you. And yeah, and we're off.
All right.
Dope. See you, dude.
See you, man. Have fun.
Thank you, man.
So we're heading over to Reggie's now.
Yeah, man.
And you've known him for quite a while. Like it's been
a few years
since you've been here almost.
Yeah. I mean, since before Fangs was a thing.
That's great. So you, how long has it been since you've had a chance to catch up with him?
It's been a minute because he's been touring so much. His record just came out. I've been touring so much and, like, working on my record. So it's been a little while. It'll be good to, like, just hang it for a minute. It'll be probably different than all the other homes.
All right. Awesome. Let's get it.
But yeah, okay, so we can start, I guess, with... Yeah, so I moved to Nashville, which is where we are currently, in 2015. It was December 1st of 2015, and I bought a one-way ticket and just was like, I'm doing it, I'm leaving. You know, back in Florida.
Yeah.
Yeah, back in Florida, where I'm from, I was playing, basically playing in bars, essentially doing the Broadway thing, you know, but just at the college bars, the UCF bars and stuff back there, and like... Just imagine me, like, with a TV this big over the top of my head, and the UCF Knights are doing well, really, really well at football at this point, you know what I'm saying? And I'm there singing John Mayer songs, you know, and trying to get these bro dudes to pay attention to me, you know what I'm saying? That was how I, like, was cutting my teeth and like learning to perform live, but also it was like I can do something bigger than this. Like I need to go somewhere where there's some infrastructure. Shout out to Florida. Florida raised me and gave me everything I have, but I just had to make a move because there just wasn't the infrastructure to support it. So yeah, I decided to come up here because Chris was already up here. Chris Martiniago is my manager and longtime friend. And I feel like there should be like a cut into him there and it'll say, manager, longtime friend. At the bottom third, yeah. I didn't ask to be in this. But yeah, Chris was already here a little bit before me and running around and stuff. And I met Jake at the first job that I got there.
Yeah.
And that was a rough time in my life. I can't speak for you, but
yeah, I mean, for exactly. Both of us, like,
yeah. It was.
My life.
This is not great.
Way crazy. that
year.
In a lot of ways.
Yeah, it did. Yeah. I forgot about all that. Yeah. but anyway, probably my cereal eating here. I'm rude, so whatever. But
gotta eat.
Straight up, this is my first meal of the day. But yeah, I just remember. That was my first job. And our other mutual friend, Kirk, get your weight up, Ellis, you know, or weight room, Ellis, that's what it was, would, he literally just hired me, like, sight unseen. Shout out to Kirk, wherever he is, because I didn't have a job when I moved here and had, like, basically no money. But I was working at this little factory.
Yeah.
It was called South by Sea, and basically we were just folding t-shirts and stuff for sororities and printing t-shirts and all that stuff, and we used to work on the side where we just actually had to count and fold and do all the things. It was a lot more heavy lifting than we expected.
It was just like weird, tedious work.
Yeah, that was in the loudest place possible.
With no AC or heat.
No AC. Oh my God, this is all, this it was misery. All this trauma is like coming back in real time. It was a brick building with one exhaust port like above.
And there's like chemicals that are like
spraying chemicals. Yeah, they're the dudes that were on the hot side because they were like the dryers, and it was literally an oven with just an open side that was always like 400 degrees to burn all the stuff onto the shirts. Blah, 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 whatever. But this is my first job. This is also the first time I'd ever been working a 40-hour week job. And so honestly, I was pretty miserable at the time, I think, because I'm sure Jake remembers this one particular low point where I'm from Florida and I moved here in December. I don't really account for snow. People told me that it was sleet really badly. And this was, I mean, I recently cut my hair, but when my hair was really long, like I'll show you a photo, basically, like when my hair was like this length, basically, I was, did you get that?
Get the stats too. Get them numbers. Get them numbers now. Let them know.
Right? As I picked it up, I'm like, this is a weird flex. This is a weird half flex, right? But anyway, yeah, when my hair was that long, I was walking to South by Sea because I had to walk. It was like a 20-minute walk, 20, 25-minute walk. I was walking.
You had like house shoes on.
It was, where are they? I still have them.
You still got them?
Yes, I love those shoes. I wear them all the time. Where are they? I'm going to find them. This is important.
There they are. Just wrecked.
Just disgusting, decrepit. They're talking on the bottom.
Oh my God.
You can literally, like.
They're yelling. They're talking.
They're shouting. They're screaming. I can literally look at you through the shoes. So I'm walking up the street, and Jake drives by me in his like tiny little SUV, and we didn't really know each other at the time. Yeah. This was after we had initially met, but he was like, "Hey, man, do you want to ride?" And
we're stuck. It was a train. Yeah. A train was going, so you're just standing at a train.
That. Oh God, I forgot about
like,
that.
Like in the snow, and his entire like all the hair was just like covered in snow.
Frost. I literally had to go into the, and I'm not kidding. I had to go into the bathroom, which was not fully constructed and shared with the women.
Weird. You could hear each other.
Seriously. And through the like plywood drywall.
Yeah.
And he walked in and I would have to go into the bathroom and dry my hair under the hair dryer and just let it melt out all the ice. And it was terrible. This sounds like one of those stories where your grandfather's like, I used to walk uphill twice both ways in the snow. But like I literally walked uphill in the snow to go to this awful job. But yeah, so and the first time we had met was you were walking in the front door.
Mm-hmm.
And as you sort of come around the corner from the front door, you can see the entire sort of work floor. And me and Chris, the other person he's referencing, Chris Klein, we're just probably working or whatever, and Kirk calls us both over to come do something with a pallet or something, I don't know.
Yeah.
Calls us both over, didn't know who this person was. He calls for someone, because I believe Jake was the first volunteer, and then he was like, oh, I need somebody else. And then he asked Chris, and I think maybe Chris said no. And then he asked me, and then I was like, you want the black guy to come work and come lift or something like that? Because obviously that made Kirk feel very uncomfortable. Yeah. And Kirk is like a skinny white dude.
It's like
he was
the
like,
first thing I heard come out of your mouth.
I mean, yeah, but I mean, not like that, but like, barf, you know? Because that's funny. And to review, I'm rude. South by Sea seems like such a long time ago, even though it's less than 5 years.
Yeah.
And our lives are so drastically different now. You know, I used to, when I moved here, I was living in like a bedroom, not really a bedroom, like a loft.
Attic,
and upstairs,
yeah.
Basically an attic. But the rent was like $325 or some shit.
Yeah.
And like, I could afford it. And work that job that I hated and save up to, you know, get a bass or profit or whatever.
I remember when you got the vocal.
Oh yeah.
That was like a big deal. I remember
the,
that.
The TCL Con Voice Live Touch 2, I got it because Kimbra got it and she's like a god. So
I remember that. And you only had the guitar that you won. And
that Les Paul Studio. Wow. Damn, will you write my autobiography?
I just remember.
I don't remember a lot of that stuff. Yeah,
I just remember thinking it was lucky.
Weird
that you played a Les Paul.
Yeah, it was.
And you were like,
lucky.
I was free.
And it was so heavy. I have a shoulder problem, so it's too heavy for me. But and that's why I switched it up and switched to a Strat, but it's over there off camera somewhere. But yeah, man, that was it's interesting though that like a certain purity in that. There's like also in the Tim Paul record. I don't know if you listened to that yet.
Yeah.
But I think this one might be called like Lost in Time or something. I don't remember all the titles, but there's a lyric on it about like him essentially missing the kind of like purity of that struggle. You know what I'm saying? The purity of it being a, like we were so happy. It felt like we were, you know, even though we were struggling, but it felt like there was something so much more like genuine to it. There was something, it was so much
more pure. We were just talking about earlier that it was a cool time because there was no true expectation yet.
Yeah.
That like we were just making
the lack of
stuff
expectation.
That was cool.
That's the hardest.
We were just like trying to make something tight that
you
we
think
thought was tight.
You feel something.
But that like we felt
absolutely
something and our gauge on that was each other.
Mm-hmm.
And just
whoever,
like saying each other songs
shows
and just being like, is this tight? Like, should I
do
play
you like
this live?
Do you think anybody will give a shit about this?
Yeah.
Because I can tell from the internet. I don't fucking know.
Mm-hmm.
It's still, and it's even worse now. It's just a shit show, you know?
Yeah.
And, but that like kind of, but I think you nailed it actually. I feel like it is the lack of expectation that in a sense, it's like, I personally have trouble dealing with, what is the right word? Dealing with lacking specificity or feeling lost or not having like a goal or a point or something like that. You know what I'm saying? So that really was a strange and like formative time for me because I was really lost. I definitely had just come here by myself. It was just like, I mean, I had Chris who was sort of doing his own thing and but helping, not Chris.
Yeah, yeah.
Chris Martinyago, not Chris Klein. He's my manager who had come here before. Whoa, speaking
cut
of boy.
To him again.
But yeah, I know.
All right.
I don't know what this is for, but yeah, it was just strange because so much of that was so like just pure. Fast forwarding, that job was definitely really formative because we were making a lot of things and just meeting people, and I felt like it was a special time where everybody was working really, really hard in the scene, and there was a lot of attention here and all these things. I came here because I knew that I would be able to do something different.
Well, there wasn't even a true
looking
like thing yet. Like
it was not a true thing.
Like
No. It was not a true thing. I just had some like, and for my own project, I had a little bit of success with Frustrated at that point because we had put it up on TuneCore and maybe had like 4 or 5 million plays or something like that. Which at the time, me and Chris were like, "Yo, we're gonna be millionaires," and still not. But it all progressed and we all kept working and stuff like that. And he graduated because I don't know what you did next. What did you? You just were able to quit, right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, the Reliant K tour. So you know, life flex. but he's like, I can text my hoops right now. You know what I'm saying? And he'll pick up. You know what I'm saying? But he'd be like, hey man, you want some guitar pedals, man?
Yeah.
He sounds like he's high, but he's not, and that's the funny part.
The most chilled,
right? Most chilled human being. But yeah, so he graduated because he left for the Reliant K thing. I think Chris got a job at Atlantic.
Yeah.
Right? Klein got a job at Atlantic, C-Line. And then I was the last. I was a super senior. It took me quite a while to graduate. But I did. I got fired, actually.
Yeah,
yeah, I forgot. I didn't graduate. I got expelled. So Damn it, I forgot that. I totally got fired. Damn it. And that was the push for me to be like, I'm just going to figure it out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't care. I'm just going to figure it out. Like, I didn't come here to work 60 hours or whatever in a factory, you know, and sweat my life away for something that is not serving me or serving the people who listen to this music, people who are like helped by this music, you know. I say this a lot. I'm such a granddad. I have all these sayings and shit, but one of them is, and I truly believe, is that music is a service industry and that you're here to serve the fans. You're here to serve the people that believe in the music because you have the ability now, at least we've developed the ability that the people that I loved when I was younger have.
Totally.
Like you can pan around, come around here, actually, pan around here. And then look at my wall. Or just turn around. There you go. Come around and look at the wall. These are all my favorite bands. Who cares if you see the production? Whatever. These are all my favorite bands. You know, National, Paramore, Kimbra, Tame Impala, 1975, Beatles, James Blake, Frank Ocean, Ray LaMontagne, and Radiohead. These are my favorite ones that I've gotten posters of. There's a lack of Cohen and Cambria up here, but forgive me. And just like all the records and all that stuff. These people have this ability, to me, to like codify how you feel, you know? Even if it's like a thing where you feel it, but you don't have the words for it, or you can't like tell people really how it is. It's hard even to explain for me, I think.
Jake was telling me when you guys like graduated or moved on from the place, one of his first show was with you.
Love it. Oh yeah, first, and then come,
the first
come,
tour
come,
was come,
come, first tour.
Oh yeah, you got it on the wall.
Right there. Wow. And definitely at that point, I feel like we noticed really early on with your shit where it was like, oh, people are like really invested. Like,
people drove like real far for that particular show.
For like hours and hours. Mm. Like, damn, this dude's an opener. He's got like 5 songs out. Like, these kids are like really attaching to this. There's something in it, maybe the nostalgia or like the understanding of who you're talking to or your experiences or something that is just so like, it seems. It just clicks with them, you know? And I think it's cool the way, we've talked about this, you know, off camera, and I'm sure on camera as well now too, but like, this is interesting seeing like, even from like a numbers perspective, seeing like, just how engaged and excited and how much they interact with each other is great. You know, that's the really cool thing. And that's when you can see that, you know, going back to the service industry thing again, rant part 2, get buckle in kids. Granddad's been sipping the liquor, so he's feeling away. I haven't. It's like 2:30. I'm not drunk. but also, I'm not a day drinker. Anyway. It's cool to, going back to the service industry thing, it empowers them to empower each other, which is so good. Like, that's the dream. That's what you want. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And you've done it. And you're doing it. So, shout out to where it came from.
Yeah.
It's always been you. time being reckless. Kick sand indecision got me restless. Should've stayed where I always run away from you. Guess it's always been true. Too busy proving that I'm worth it. So stuck searching for somebody perfect. I don't think I ever really told the truth. But I guess it's always been you.
Got a house show.
That's it. That's
the
one.
For free, baby. Let's get it.
Tight.
How that feel? Are you good?
Yeah,
it's great.
Yeah, but welcome to my home. I'm so glad you could come.
Yeah,
this is the first time Jake has been to this house actually. So
it is
very good.
My first time too.
Yeah. I mean, it is way.
Yeah, guys, thank you for coming.
Yeah,
and thanks for sharing a lot of shit. You know, I really didn't remember a lot of that stuff.
It's crazy.
A lot of stuff.
Thank you. Yeah.
Dude.
Man, walking around and hearing about the new stuff coming up makes me excited because I've known you for a while.
Yeah.
But I guess I've never really, we never got a chance to do something like this or even to know these stories like from Reggie or, you know, to see what Tom's habitat is like. It uses, it adds to it. It adds to the excitement of what's upcoming.
Yeah, I'm glad that like we got to dive into this world, and I don't know, I think that's one of the main things that I try to make for these listeners is like to like make an actual setting for these people to understand. I don't know, I feel like everything is so single based or Instagram based and stuff now that I'm excited to make an actual like space for something to live that's like an actual habitat, you know.
Well, that's awesome.
So yeah.
Well, yeah. Sweet.
Back at the house.
Can't wait. We're back here. I'm gonna head out.
Thanks for walking around.
Two men.
Cool.
Later.
Saw you and made you laugh. I can't wait to tell you how somehow you split my heart in half. And when you're crying, I stayed up all night so you'd be alright. Yeah, sonny, you'll be alright. I can't wait to tell you.
Good morning. us anyway.
I can't wait to tell you about hitting the road and playing these shows. I can't wait to tell you about the friends that I made and the song that we wrote. And I can't wait to show you every state I drove through. I was thinking about you. Oh, I'm thinking about you. I can't wait to tell you.